Good morning, church family. Hope you're having a great Thursday. And trust that you've had a good week to this point. And we're so excited about being able to join together today and study the book of Acts. We're in Acts chapter 16. We'll begin our time together in verse number 1. And as Pastor John said, our last time together is one of his all-time favorite passages in the Bible because it's where we are introduced to really the leaders of the church at Philippi. This is where the church in Philippi is birthed out of Acts chapter 16. It's also where we get introduced to a young man by the name of Timothy. Mm-hmm. And such a fond relationship that the Apostle Paul had with him. He described him as his son in the faith. And I'm sure Timothy felt the same way by feeling that Paul was his father in the faith. Kind of. Right. And so we're going to begin reading there in verse number 1. So you join with us, Acts chapter 16. And we'll go as far as we can as time allows this morning. So Acts chapter 16 verse 1 says, "Then came he to Derbe and Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus, the son of a certain woman which was a Jewess, and believed, but his father was a Greek, which was well reported of by the brethren that were at Lystra and Iconium. Him would Paul have to go forth with him, and took and circumcised him because of the Jews which were in those quarters, for they knew all that his father was a Greek." And so really when we open up this passage of Scripture, it really is revolving around Timothy, his history. We're introduced somewhat to his mother, who was a Jew, but his father was a Greek. And we know that from other Scripture readings that his grandmother and his mother were believers.
Yes.
Faith was in them. It's interesting, though, that it says, but his father was a Greek. I don't know that there's much said about Timothy's dad. This is probably all there is. Kind of leads us to believe, you know, he may have not necessarily had a relationship with the Lord. We don't know what kind of home life he had, but Paul took an interest in him. And kind of took him under his wing,
right.
And really, the rest is kind of history.
That's right. You know, the mother and the grandmother, the Bible makes it clear, was the main influence on Timothy in bringing him up. They became believers, and in 2 Timothy, we read about them, his mother and his grandmother, and we don't hear a lot about his father. We know his dad was Greek, which was Gentile. We know that Timothy did not have to be circumcised, but chooses to be,
right.
Because he didn't want that to ever interfere with his audience, and so he made that extra step of circumcision so that that could be a possibility. So, you know, when you look in this, maybe a lesson we learn is never underestimate what pouring into one child can become.
Right.
You know, you see this grandmother and this mother pouring into Timothy. And the Bible, God, through the Holy Spirit, wanted us clearly to see the work and the influence of that mother and that grandmother.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, I think we all know this to be the truth. If you've paid attention in church any at all, you see more mothers and grandmothers than fathers. And you see a lot of them bringing those children. A lot of the dads are absent from church. Not all, but there are many situations that it is the mother or grandmother. And I just want to encourage them today, and that the work you're doing, even as grandparents, every time that you whisper in those ears and read those Bible stories and you encourage those grandchildren, even maybe their home life is not exactly what it needs to be, but you know, you're having a tremendous influence in the life of those children, just like they had in the life of Timothy. And so I think that's one of the great, great things we can take away immediately from this man, Timothy, and how God hooks him up with Paul. You know, we just looked at John Mark and Paul had problems.
Right.
But on the flip side, there are those who are meant to work with us.
Sure.
There are those who are not meant to work with us, but there are those. So, you know, and I think we'll find that person we're meant to work with and work next to. And seems like Timothy came into Paul's life at a real good time during this time.
Yep, absolutely. Well, let's dig a little bit further. The Bible says that, obviously, as Pastor John noted there, that he was circumcised. He went that extra mile, Timothy yeah. did, to avoid being a stumbling block. And so look what happens in verse 4. It says, as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for to keep that were ordained of the apostles and elders which were at Jerusalem. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. So you see Paul and you see Timothy doing exactly what Paul has been doing all along.
Right.
He's faithfully going and preaching. He's delivering the decrees that have come from, as we talked a couple of weeks ago, about the church at Jerusalem being kind of the hub of the early Christian church.
Mm-hmm.
Decrees were often sent out from there. And so Paul and Timothy were just simply going around to the churches that were established in the faith. And as they were doing so, they were preaching the gospel. And according to the verse 5 here, it says, and they increased in number daily.
That's right.
I mean, it's amazing what will happen when the gospel is preached. If we're faithfully committed to preach and teach the gospel, it's not about a kind of a bait and switch. We get you here, and then we get you into the family.
Yeah.
If we just simply preach the gospel and let the gospel speak for itself, it's amazing what the gospel can and will do if we'll just simply sit back and just be a vessel
yeah.
that God can use. And that's what Paul and Timothy were doing here. So let's pick up there in verse 6. It says, now when they had gone through out to Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia, after they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. And they, passing by Mysia, came down to Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto him.
Mm.
And so I think what's important to see here is there are certain places that the Spirit of God said, you're not supposed to go there.
Right.
But there were other places that the Spirit of God was prompting them to go.
Yeah.
And I think there's a lot to be said of that. I think we can be gung-ho in our zeal for the Lord and just go and throw caution to the wind and not really listen to the Spirit's leadership. But then there's also the other flip side of that where we're so timid that we don't do anything for the Lord. But I think the happy medium is found here where we're sensitive enough to the Spirit of God. When the Spirit of God says, don't go there, then don't go there.
Right, right. And we don't have direct. In verse 6, it's not as direct as it is when we hear see the vision to go to Macedonia.
Right.
We don't know how Paul figured this out not to go, except right. that the Holy Spirit had forbidden them. They were right. forbidden by the Holy Spirit. Well, was that in a dream? Was that in a vision? We don't know.
Right.
But there's one thing that Paul had. He had a feeling. We know he had something going on. And I was reading a note here that I think is very applicable as we study this. We see in verse 6 that the Holy Spirit forbade them from going somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
We see on over now in verses 8 through 10 that they are then told where to go.
Mm-hmm.
The Spirit of God is the one doing the directing. How do we know? How do we know
right.
that what we're supposed to do? And I was reading that when we're seeking God's will, that number one, we need to make sure that our plan is in harmony with God's plan.
Amen.
You know? The first thing we want to do is make sure that what we are intending to do is what God wants done.
Right.
And sometimes it is so easy to just outrun God and do our own thing, even with good intention,
absolutely,
even with good motivation, but it can still be the wrong place, the wrong time.
Yeah.
We have to be careful about doing things in harmony,
mm-hmm.
in the timing of God,
right.
at the right season of God. You may have a wonderful, wonderful vision and a wonderful plan, but it's not time.
Yeah.
This is not like they were going to go to a place with bad intention. They were going to go there to preach,
yeah.
but the Spirit of God said no.
Right.
And then secondly, we need to ask other mature Christians for their advice.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's good to sit down, and I do this with you an awful lot. I come through and say, I know you know, you're like, uh-oh, here it comes. But a lot of times I'll go in Pastor Mark's office and sit down and say, let me just throw something out at you.
Yeah.
And I do that because I want to give him the opportunity to give some sound feedback.
Yeah.
Because sometimes when we're thinking about something, we're only thinking one direction.
Right.
We need to hear the other direction, hear it from another side. Plus, I've got a prayer warrior who now joins in with me saying, and I'm sure you've done this many a night working with me, oh, God, if this ain't right, you've got to show us and show him. And, you know, and I've appreciated those times where you've sat back down with me and say, well, what about this? And I could tell you was thinking about it. So number one, we need to be in harmony with God, but we also ought to talk it through with mature believers.
Yeah,
be careful who we choose to do that. Thirdly, check our motives.
Yeah.
Why do we want to do what we're doing? Yeah,
absolutely.
You know, and what is the motivation behind what I'm? Am I seeking to do what I want,
right,
or is this really what God wants?
Yeah.
And making sure that it's what God wants. And then I would say, fourthly, I agree with this note: pray for God to open and close the doors of our circumstances.
Yeah.
You know, that's the thing that I think is key when we get through with everything is, God, if you want this done, throw that door wide open,
right,
and show us exactly what needs to be done. And I can honestly tell you guys that today I could sit here for the next hour and talk about the doors God opened and it was so clear, and the doors God shut that was so clear. You know, we are in the building we're sitting in doing this Bible study was no doubt an open door of
Absolutely.
God. No doubt that God opened that door. Now, sometimes we scratch our head and wonder,
right,
you know, could we not have gone through everything we've gone through back at the other building? Well, God said no. There was a strong feeling, and God brought us together, and we got in harmony, and we talked it out, we discussed it out, we prayed it through, and God showed us. Mm. So we don't know exactly how God showed Paul not to go to Asia,
right,
but we do know for sure that God abundantly made it clear he was to go to Macedonia.
Absolutely.
And that's the thing, guys. Let God close doors and let God open doors. I'm reminded of what a pastor's wife once told me about her husband. She said, I am so sick of him kicking down the doors that God has shut.
Yeah.
That can be a very frustrating thing, that
right,
we just got to make it happen.
Yeah.
We're trying to kick a door down that God has clearly shut. And if God shuts that door, he's got something else. He has a Macedonia.
Yeah, there's a reason.
There's a reason
in behind that. And then, you know, we move through this and seeing God say no to certain areas and saying yes to other areas. And you know, the thing of it is that we got to trust that God's still in the watering phase when it comes to perhaps maybe Asia, where the Spirit of God said, nope, I don't want you to go there yet.
It's not time.
We got to trust that God in his sovereign plan is still watering the seeds that are being planted in that general area. And there's going to come a time when a harvest will be reaped. And then, when we look in verse 10, there's an interesting thing that happens. If you'll notice there, it says, and after he had seen the vision, immediately we.
We.
There's a change in the usage of pronouns here in the book of Acts. And literally what this is where Luke, the author of the book of Acts, is now going to join Paul in these journeys. He's coming alongside now. He can no longer write they.
Right.
He's got to include himself. These are the what's called the W-E passages in the book of Acts.
Yes.
So that's kind of what's going on here in Acts chapter 16, verse number 10. Luke is joining with them, and I can't imagine the encouragement, not only from the physical standpoint of having a doctor with you now.
Yeah, yeah.
Dr. Luke is with them, but more fellowship, more camaraderie, and isn't it interesting that we see the separating of ways in chapter 15, and now what God does in chapter 16 is he brings Timothy into Paul's life.
Yes.
And now in verse number 10, we have Luke join the journey, and so there is a blessing that seems to be taking place on the life of Paul here where God's bringing some more people into his life to be an encouragement and strengthen him.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, there's, like we say, we use the word, there's seasons for things. And we may not understand why Barnabas and Paul had to have an argument about John Mark, but what we do see is the work of God continuing to flourish, and they're all doing work. And as Mark mentioned in Tuesday's Bible study, you had two groups that were doing the work. They were splitting that load now, and Luke's been included, and the Holy Spirit is ushering them to certain places. And what we learn from the book of Philippians and the letter Paul writes to them, we learn that while he was here with this church, he receives a gift.
Yeah.
And they bless him.
Yeah,
they really are a church that he is very passionate about. They were good to him. So God had a plan for him, and that plan was to take him to Macedonia and to watch the church at Philippi be birthed. And, you know, that's the thing today. We just got to learn again. We need to hear again and again. We know it. But God does have a plan. God has an ultimate purpose in everything. And there'll be a time that we have to just lean on him more and more and his timing and showing us exactly what to do. I know right now that Pastor Mark and I are praying through about what needs to happen in uncertain days. When do we make next steps?
Right.
At some point, the church has to come back and be the church. And we just got to plow forward. And, you know, you and I are beginning to feel that burden more and more strongly.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit will never lead us wrong. Now, the thing of it is we don't want to act out of frustration. We don't want to act out of desperation. Mm-hmm. We want to move when God says move. We want to move Calvary Road back into some sense of normalcy, back on these grounds, studying the Word of God, overcoming our fears. We've let the devil, he's really taken a stronghold in a lot of our lives in this country, that what started out as something none of us knew about, now we have a lot of facts about. And so, like Paul saying, God, where do we go next? God made it clear. Then let's all pray that God makes that clear in all of our lives and in the life of the church. We would never want to put anybody in harm's way. But then as pastors, we're also thinking how much harm is being done by the body of Christ not being together.
Yeah.
We are becoming weak as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
The irritability factor in our nation is at an all-time high. We were meant to be together. We were meant to worship together. God built us the church. It's his idea. And I look at this, and my takeaway is God, if you knew exactly where Paul and Silas and Luke needed to be at this exact time in history,
You
know where we're supposed to be and how we need to take the next step and how we need to overcome some things to see you move in power and all of us get back to that place where we're drawing from God again. And I think God's got us. I know he does.
Yeah.
But the thing about it, my daddy gave me some advice. When we were riding back and forth to Bible college, he told me one time, he said, son, you'll never go wrong by preaching the word, loving the people. But he gave me a third piece of advice that's always stuck with me. And don't outrun God.
Amen.
Preach the word, love the people, and don't outrun God. This is a faith journey that we're all on. And I think when it comes to COVID, Pastor Mark, you know, it's been since March. It's been since early March. And what was a lot of unknowns are now knowns.
Right.
You know? And we're able to deal with it a little bit better. We're able to know it's a virus that's not going away and people are going to get sick. And at some point, and that's not trying to take away from anything, but at some point we got to move forward and, you know, we got to take steps and leaps of faith with God and pray for us as we're trying to figure out what that looks like. You know, school's back in this week. And I know a lot of it's virtual, but I know that all of us are trying to make sound decisions about what to do with our children, what to do with our lives. But some of those decisions have been made for us by God. Mm-hmm. And he made a decision for Paul here. Paul, go to Macedonia. Yeah. That's where I want you. And I think here we sit in late August, and you know, God's burdening us right now. Yes. That something else needs to happen.
Right.
And pray that we'll make those right steps, because when we do try to make sure we're in harmony with God's will, mm-hmm. and we're praying it through and talking it out, I believe God's going to show us clearly.
Yeah, I think so. I think we just got to trust the fact that God knows who we are and where we are, what we're going through, but what we need.
Yes.
I'm thankful that God sees the greater picture, and at some point we've got to start making decisions based on our faith and our commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, again, I think for so many of us, it's a challenging place to be, because there is so much data that's being put out there. Yeah. By so many different people.
Yeah.
And what we've learned, if we've learned anything, is that any given set of data can be used to prove any point. I mean, you can find facts to back up your agenda if you just dig deep enough and long enough.
If you've got Facebook, you've seen that.
Oh, goodness, yeah. I mean, you've got so much that's going on. But what we need to do more than anything is, in this day and hour, in this age that we are living in, when so much is uncertain, what we need to do is we need to literally put our face in God's Word and seek His will for our life, and to live our faith out boldly, declaring that we believe and trust in the God of heaven,
yeah,
who has made provision for our greatest need,
yes,
our need for a Savior, willingly sent His own Son to die for us. Folks, our allegiance is to Jesus and to Jesus alone. I'm an American by birth, a patriot by choice, but I am a saved follower of Christ by the new birth.
Yeah.
And my allegiance resides with Jesus.
Yeah.
I want to go with God. I don't want to get ahead of Him. I don't want to fall behind Him. I want to finish my race. As Pastor Seth talked about, I still just a great message last Sunday, talking about running the race, and doing so by laying aside every weight that does so easily beset us. And that's not just sin, but that's other things that can press in on us that are not necessarily bad.
Right, right.
But things that could press in on our life that take away and pull our attention away from our relationship with the Lord. And I just think that what God desires from all of us is that in these uncertain times, God longs for us to deepen our relationship with Him by spending time in His Word, consulting Him, and trusting His leadership,
yeah,
letting God lead us,
yeah,
not us being led by the flesh.
And that's what's happening here. The Holy Spirit is doing the leading.
That's right. That's the key thing.
And Paul and them are listening.
Yeah, right.
And I think, Mark, that what I think where our heart is we want our motives to be right.
Right.
There's a time that we wanted to reopen church just in our flesh as a motive. The motive was to just, let's show them, you know, let's just get back at it. I think it's my motive is more moved to, I see what it's doing to the church, the body of Christ. We are losing our muscle mass spiritually.
Yeah.
And I would ask anybody right now, just a point blank question. If you've stayed at home since March, do you feel spiritually stronger than you did when you were in church on a regular basis? And we've even been in the building for several weeks, but I still, without that whole gathering of the body of Christ, we are still struggling.
Yeah.
And, you know, let's just pray. Listen, here's the facts today, and I don't know why God would want us, you know, this is where we're at.
This is, yeah.
We're trying to obey the Holy Spirit here and making decisions, but also in this Bible study right now. And the fact of the matter is let's pray together that, yeah, we want COVID to go away, but let me ask you something. What do you think people are really waiting on? I'd love to hear that. If it's a virus that's not going away, some say they're waiting on a vaccine, but there's so many unknowns with a vaccine.
Sure.
Are we willing to wait that long? I mean, are we going to stay out of the house of God and away from the normalcy of worship for that long? And just let's pray as God's people. If you can show Paul not to go to Asia and show him to go to Macedonia, you can show us
absolutely
what we need to do next.
Absolutely.
And that's exactly where we're at in the leadership walk here in the church. And, you know, I think that's just a good stopping off point for us today is the Holy Spirit's leading and guiding. Let's let him lead and guide us. Maybe you're one of those that watch our Bible study and you're asking God. We'll ask God with you about what you need to do and how you need to make a decision. And, you know, I know that the devil's having a field day with churches being so torn apart and disconnected and people. I want to make very clear that while we come to you by the avenue of media, that is not the design God had for his church.
Yeah.
He doesn't want virtual church.
Right.
And I realize there are homebound people who cannot physically get to church, and I thank God for that.
Amen.
But we have to realize at some point we've got to unplug from that.
Yeah.
And we've got to step back in to his plan, and that is being in his house among his people, all crying out to him, all worshiping him.
Right.
I spent a little bit of time yesterday going to YouTube and watching some videos of churches in worship, packed, people standing with their hands in the air, tears dripping off their cheeks, people on their knees. And I'm feeling more and more, Mark, that's greater than a vaccine.
Yeah.
And, you know, we can't know who's going to get COVID no more, and we're going to know who's going to get strep throat or the flu or cancer. We don't know.
Yeah.
We just don't know. Every day we get on the highway, we take a risk.
Yeah.
Every day we get up and walk through life, we have no idea what's going to come to us next. And I'm just praying that as clear as God showed Paul and what the result was in the church at Philippi, you know, that he show us clearly. And I'm beginning to be burdened more and more as I spent time on vacation. The burden is growing that we're reaching a time that, you know, guys, enough's enough. We're going to have to learn to live with this thing. And I think, as I've told you, that on August the 30th, I guess it is, we're going to have our outdoor service here. We're going to have great singing here. We're going to be on the grounds here in the amphitheater. But God is really burdening me over a message to bring to our church family that night. And let's just pray together, guys, because there's never been days of what I would call great certainty. Every day is uncertain. The only thing that's certain is that God's on the throne, that I know I'm saved, and each day I just going to have to take a step of faith with him. We are in some times like none of us have ever been in, and I think what we're fixing to see as the election grows nearer and nearer is hell being unleashed more and more.
Yeah.
And I think we need to be together to get through that. I don't think staying apart is going to help. I think we need to be together.
Amen.
And God help us to be brave. And if he tells us to make these faith steps, that we'll do it.
Amen.
Well, we love you today. We thank you so much. And make sure that you follow us and you watch. We're going to be doing a video concerning this Sunday service. And the events that are coming up, and So you just continue to follow us. Thank you for watching us on Bible studies. And today, I know we might have run a rabbit, but I think it was a rabbit God wanted us to run. I feel burdened that we need to pray. I feel burdened about the state of the church as a whole, the body of Christ, but I feel very burdened over this church, Amen. This body that God's entrusted to us to be Amen. The leaders of. And we're burdened. I want you to know our staff is burdened over this church. And that burden has not weakened. It's grown. And, you know, we're praying diligently about the next moves to make. There comes a time, Mark's already said it, we have to set our fear aside, yeah. and we have to walk by faith. Amen. I think these are the hours that we need to show our children, we need to show our grandchildren, that Jesus comes first. Above all other things, our walk with Him and the promises He's made us in Scripture, we trust Him and we don't lean on our own understanding, and we're going to acknowledge Him in all of our ways. And let's pray that the return of God's church is sooner than later, because of the hell that is being unleashed on our world right now. We need each other more now than we ever have. And that burden is continuing to intensify. So stay with us as we study God's Word, and pray with us as we study God's Word. And we love you, and we'll see you when we see you. Well, thanks for being with us in worship today. It is our heart's desire that through the Word and through this worship service today, God has spoken to your heart, and you desire to serve Him and to worship Him more than you ever have in your life. You know, if you've been watching today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, that is our greatest desire. If we can be a help to you, if we can assist you in any way, please contact us at the information you see on the screen. We also want to thank those of you who watch us regularly. We greatly appreciate your prayer and support. Keep praying for us as we pray for you, as we serve the Lord together.